We're gonna enter into his courts with praise and be thankful unto him. And be thankful unto him, for he is worthy.
Let's try one more time. Good morning, City Temple.
Good morning.
Let's bring out our Bible for our prophetic reading, the three angels' message. We'll be reading Revelation 14, starting from verse 6 to 12. I will read from verse 6. To 11, and the entire congregation will read all together verse 12. I want you to pay good attention to the wordings of the three angels' message. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindreds and tongues and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the seas and the fountains of water. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his designation. And he shall be tormented with the fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascended up forever and ever, and they have no rest, nor day or night, who worship the beast and his image, whatsoever received the mark of his name. Altogether, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandment of God, faith of Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless his reading. Let us pray. Great and marvelous are your deeds, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, King of the ages, who will not fear you, O Lord, and bring glory to your name. For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship before you, for your righteous acts have been revealed in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, Jesus Saves, found in your hymn books number 340. We're going to sing all four verses.
We have heard a joyful sound.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath to everybody. It's time now for our children's story. Children, would you come forward for our children's story?
I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise. With a capital.
The funds that are being collected at this time are for the children's education, for Christian education.
Oh, yes, and I am learning.
So the dollars that are being collected now is for Christian education.
I'm trying to make the right choice. I am a promise.
We have a few more coming.
Anything God wants me to be. I am a promise, I am a possibility, I am a promise, with a capital P, I am a great big bundle of potentiality, oh yes, and I am learning to hear God's voice, and I'm trying to make the right choice, I am a promise to be. Anything God wants me to be.
All right, well, happy Sabbath, everyone. Okay, I didn't hear the children. Happy Sabbath, boys and girls. Okay. Well, today I have a special bag, and I need your help to try to determine what's inside of it. So I'm going to give you a couple of cues for you to guess what it is. Okay? So it's hard on one end and soft on the other end. Sometimes it's short and sometimes it's long. It's typically round, but sometimes it can be in another shape as well. Sometimes it's yellow, and I've also seen it in a lot of other colors as well. Can anybody try to guess what they think it might be?
What's that?
No? Okay, someone else want to guess? Okay. I know. Can someone open up this bag and pull one out for me? Okay.
A pencil.
It's a pencil. Right, so pencils are made with a lot of differences, but they all have something in common. In what ways are pencils the same? And that one thing is that they all have lead in them. And for the most part, the only way that it can be used is for it to be sharpened, correct? So let's talk about how pencils are the same or like boys and girls. Let's see. So boys and girls come in all different types of shapes and sizes and colors. But what is that one thing that they all have in common? It is this, and never forget it, that you are all the same because Jesus loves you. You are all his special boys and girls. So let's see. I'm going to choose one of these pencils. I have one in my lap. So between the two pencils that I have, does it matter which one that I use if I want to write something on it? Yes. Okay. You say no. So would I be able to write anything with this unsharpened pencil? No. Right. So do you know how Jesus sharpens us? He gives us his word, the Bible, which helps us to learn how he wants us to live. As you can see, I have a sharpened pencil in my hand. Can I have a volunteer to hold this? So I'm going to hold this right in your hand. Hold your hand open, straight open. Yep, and just lay it in your hand. So show it so everyone else can see you. Okay, so with this pencil laying in her hand, is it any useful? Okay, so would she be able to write with it laying straight in her hand? Okay, so what way must it be held in order for it to be useful? And what's that? Right, but what position must she hold her hand in? They said down. So if you hold your hand down, now is it useful? Not quite. So what is the proper way to hold a pencil? Can you show us? Very good. She's holding it tight and closely in her hand. Now, can it be in any position in order for her to write with it? No, it has to be which way? Pointed down. Now, what happens when she makes a mark on the pencil, on the paper? So what is this considered? A mark. Yeah, and this is another way in which you all are like pencils. Everything that you do and say leaves a mark. You can make people happy or you can make them sad. In another way, this pencil reminds us of Jesus. And can you all tell me what you think that might be that's found on this pencil? The eraser. Yes, the eraser removes the bad marks when Jesus forgives us and he erases our sins. So how important is it to hold the pencil just right? If we don't hold it correctly, it won't work. Just like this pencil must be held tightly in your hand, you need to remember every day to pray to Jesus and ask him to hold you tightly and lead you in the way that you should go. Okay? Can I have a boy or girl pray for us? Okay.
Dear Jesus, I hope we have a good day. I hope everybody be good tomorrow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus, thanks for waking us up in the morning and letting me see another day. And I pray for everybody in the church. And I pray for Mr. Lowland for his will. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Before you all go back to your seat, I have a special pencil for each of you. It's unsharpened, but at another time you can sharpen the pencil, okay?
I am a promise, I am a possibility, I am a promise with a capital P. I am a great big pond of potentiality. Oh yes, and I am learning to hear God's voice, and I am trying to make the right choice. I am a promise to be anything God wants me to be.
Good morning again, church.
Good morning.
Good morning again, church.
Good morning.
All right. Make sure you guys aren't asleep out there. At this time, I'm just going to read a little introduction for our special guest this morning. The music ministry is being presented by J.E.K., which stands for Joseph, Elizabeth, and Kenroy, from the Sharon SDA Church in Inkster, Michigan. They've been playing together for a little over a year now, and they love serving with the music ministry of music. They typically practice every Friday evening, and it is an awesome time of fellowship, praise, and a chance to bring in the Sabbath together. Mrs. Harsney says, through this musical collaboration, their friendship has grown. She also states, and I'm quoting, "I can personally say it has spiritually benefited me in many ways. I consider Joe and Kenroy to be my brothers, and I am honored to minister in music with them." Please, City Temple, let's welcome J.E.K., Joseph, Elizabeth, and Kenroy.
Good morning again and happy Sabbath. It's now time for the church and prayer. And just like the song that was played, trust me, trust me. And when we pray, I'm hoping that we're trusting in the Lord as we petition him. I also think of the words, one of the songs, when you want to talk to Jesus, you very simply do it. You very simply do it, for he knows your needs. Let us remember at this time, some of our sick and shut in. Ms. Washington, Minnie Goldwire, Florence Grizzle, Clarice Williams, Joyce Gatling, Lorraine Johnson, Lucille Wright, Calvin Lockett, George Morgan, April Mitchell, Barbara Newby, Gregory Booker, David Miller, Edith Wilcher, Edna Welch, Mary Collins, and Mary Butler. We also want to remember all those who have been in the hospital and recovering from hospital stay, or those in hospice or nursing homes, those residing at home that can't get out like they used to. We want to lift them up. We also want to remember our bereaving families from our own family here, the Annie Taylor family, and the Arthur Nolan family. There may be others, but at this time, this is what I have. But we know the Lord is with each and every one of us. At this time, the Lord is speaking to your hearts this morning. And I invite you to come down to the altar to make your petitions to him. Remember to trust him. At this time, you may come. Father, we come before you humbly and meekly. Lord, we're thankful for this privilege. We thank you to know that in your word you said that you would never leave us nor forsake us in any given circumstances. And at any time of the day, Lord, you are there for us. We're just grateful. Lord, we thank you for taking care of our loved ones, our sick and our shut-in, the names we have given. And there are others, Lord. Because, Lord, you said you know us, and you know us so much because you know even the number of the hairs on our head. Lord, let your Holy Spirit anoint each and every one of us here in the temple. And those who are listening on, Lord, each and every one of us are dealing with something. And everything is going on in this world that we know your coming is so soon. Lord, we pray for the leadership of our church, Pastor Samuel Thomas and his family, each of our members. Lord, we're just grateful. Continue to be with our sick and our shut in. Continue to be with those who are recovering from surgeries and procedures. And most of all, Lord, continue to give the peace and assurance to those who are bereaving at this time. Lord, we thank you for the hope that we have in you to know that you are coming back to get us, just like you said in your word. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. And forgive us where we fall short. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You hear our prayer.
How many of us believe that God hears our prayer? Do we really believe it? I believe it, that He hears our prayer. We don't always know what He wants to do with our prayers, but as mentioned previously, we just need to trust Him. That all things work together for good to them who love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. Let's continue to keep all of those in prayer. Good to see you, Dr. Kim and Aaron. We're praying for you. It's time for our tithe and offering. A part of the program that we can all participate in. The Bible says, "Bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will not open unto you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there would not be room enough to receive it." Do we believe that? We need a tithe and we need to give an offering for the purpose of operating the church, for the purpose of operating the conference, for the purpose of operating the mission field. We need to give. God owns the cattle of a thousand hills, but He wants us to be obedient and to give. God loves a cheerful giver, so let us now give cheerfully. Will the officers come forward? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the tremendous blessings you've given to each of us, all of us. Father, we pray that you would help us that we may be faithful in our tithe and offering. Help us to give. Father, we pray that you would bless that which we have left after our giving, that it may cover all of our needs. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house.
Saints of God, today is indeed a blessed day to be alive, is it not? How many of you are happy to know Jesus today? Amen. It's a good thing to know the Lord. This is the segment of our service where we welcome our guests. We don't have visitors at City Temple, we have guests. Because once you have come to City Temple as a guest, we graft you in very quickly as a family. And we are thankful today that worshiping in our presence is someone who has come from our sister church, a Seventh-day Adventist church, all the way from Hyderabad, India. Amen. Amen. We want to recognize, Michael. Michael, would you stand? He entered with me. Let's all give a City Temple welcome. He is here studying automotive engineering at the University of Michigan, Detroit. We're welcoming you, and you have a permanent place always to sit by my wife when I'm not here, all right? I want you to feel welcome. I visited Hyderabad, had the privilege of preaching there, and in fact, an entire series through rain and sun, and the Lord blessed, and the place that I've told you about where over 2,000 people joined the Seventh-day Adventist Church, became Christians, was in that community, the outlying community of Hyderabad. So it's just wonderful to have you with us. I want you to take a moment. Let's all stand. Let's all greet one another at this time as our praise team leads us in our song. And we recognize our other guests as well. Please greet our guests. Give them that special City Temple greeting.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Let's go to the announcements part. We'll do the announcements first.
Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? It's amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Until Dr. Kim returns to the congregation to appropriately recognize her, we had a privilege to give Aaron a hug. This is a tough time for the Nolan family. We have an official announcement about that that's forthcoming. It's your pastor's privilege to introduce to each one today Judge Cynthia, or Salinthia, pardon me, Judge Salinthia Miller. She holds a JD from Michigan State University College of Law. She graduated cum laude, and she holds a BA in Sociology from Wayne State University. She's a member of the Michigan District Judges Association. She is the past president of the Wolverine Bar Association. We are excited to introduce you to her and she to our congregation. And within 2 minutes, she's going to tell us a great story about who she is and what she's looking for us to do.
I want to thank you, City Temple, for your warm welcome this morning to the pastor and the angel of this house and to his lovely wife, Deidre, whom I had the pleasure of meeting this morning, to all of the mothers of the church, the deacons, trustees, and members. Good morning. My name is Salinthia Latoy Miller. I am your accessible judge at the 36th District Court here in the city of Detroit. A lot of people, thank you so very much, and God bless you. God bless you. I want to bring you greetings on behalf of my home church, St. Charles Lwanga, which you formerly know as St. Cecilia. And our pastor, Father Parker. This morning, I want to tell you briefly that I'm so excited about being here because there's so many things that I'm doing that your wonderful temple is doing. I am the founding and presiding judge over a homeless court. It's called Street Outreach Court Detroit. This was a campaign promise that I made in 2010, and we have delivered. We have put 300 people through this program. We have placed 97% of our formerly homeless citizens into stable housing, 91% into stable jobs. We have not had one person in 4 years commit a new misdemeanor or felony. So this program is working. To God be the glory. I also want to let you know that a lot of people think it's not important to consider voting for judges, and they just focus on the top of the ticket, and they vote straight Democrat or straight Republican, and they haven't voted for any judge, and they just walk right on out. You have to flip your ballot over and go to the nonpartisan section and vote for your judges. And if you don't think it's important, family, leave here today, be in a rush to your next appointment, speed a little bit, get stopped. you'll be at 36th District Court. Have a dispute with your neighbor about that bush they ran over when they backed up in their driveway and ran over your bush, and you'll be at 36th District Court. Have a problem with your landlord or your tenant, and you'll be where? 36th District Court. And you better pray and you better hope that you're going to have a judge who's going to understand that but for grace and mercy, it could be her on the other side of the podium. We need to have a judge that understands what it means to be left with $10 out of every paycheck. So when they say, judge, I need a little more time to pay, that the judge will grant them that. When they say, judge, I'm a little bit late because I was on the bus, the judge will understand that. I call the bus the iron pimp because it abused you and took your money and never ran on time. So these are the things that I understand because this is what I have lived. I have lived through 23 major surgeries, and I'm 53 years old. So when somebody tells me I have a disability, I need a little more time right now, Your Honor, I'm off work. Please work with me. I will work with them. I ask for you to remember to keep Judge Miller. I'm your accessible judge. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, Google+, and I have a website, keepjudgemiller.com. God bless you. Remember to vote your judicial section on November 8th to keep Judge Miller. Thank you, and keep me in your prayers.
She is very articulate, isn't she? She covered much ground in a short time. You know, the Bible speaks about having a righteous judge, isn't that right? And we all need Jesus, but until we get to heaven, we also need to be sure we have good earthly judges too. Amen. All right. God bless you. Thank you, Judge Miller, for coming and sharing with us. Dr. Kim, our thoughts are with you today. Came down to hug you. We're going to look at our announcements. For today, November the 5th, we have a Peterson Warren Academy Sabbath. Put this on your calendars. December the 3rd. Peterson Warren Academy Sabbath. And what that simply means is everything about that Sabbath is geared toward supporting Peterson Warren Academy. Again, please put that on your calendar. A couple things you can look for that Sabbath is the principal will be speaking. Amen. And in addition to his speaking, Mr. Dent will be here to talk about how he is training young people, the students in his classes and beyond, in prophecy and the memorization of Bible scripture. So that's important. Amen. He'll also be talking about the STEM program, and he'll explain more about that. So put that on your calendar, December the 3rd. Okay. Dr. Vincent White, who is noted nationally for training deacons, deaconesses, greeters, and ushers, will be conducting a training series here November 11, 12, and 13. That begins next Friday evening. If you did not receive that particular insert, LaTanya, if you would make sure that all of our attendees have that. It may not have been in your bulletin, but please be sure and get that. It's a part of what we are sharing with you today. Let me just share it with you from my desk as I have it. Friday evening, if you're a deacon, deaconette, greeter, usher, we want you to be in attendance Friday evening at 11. Friday evening the 11th at 7 p.m. from 7 to 9. Sabbath, November the 12th. 2:30 to 5, and of course, Dr. White will be preaching that Sabbath, and that's next Sabbath. And of course, Sunday from 9 to 11 a.m., you want to be here again for the final training that he will be providing. If you have any more, any more information, please see Deacon Smith. So again, please put that in your calendar. God's prophetic chain, that should be in your the bulletins, and we want to make you aware of our prophecy series that we're starting today at 5 o'clock. What time did I say, everybody? 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock today, God's prophetic chain, and we will hold two sessions per weekend, today at 5 o'clock and then tomorrow at 11 a.m. These are one-hour segments, and we appreciate our guests from Grand Rapids. I don't know if you came because you saw this announcement or heard about it on Facebook and other electronic or social media outlets, but nevertheless, we are glad that you're here at 5 o'clock today, God's Prophetic Chain. We start the series, and it runs all the way to December the 18th. All right? Looking at our next announcement today, we want to share with you that funeral services for our beloved elder Arthur Nolan will be held here at City Temple, his home church, the 10th, this coming Thursday at 11 a.m. The family hour is at 10 a.m., and there is public viewing Wednesday at Cole's Funeral Home. So we want you to keep these dates and times in mind that we might honor his memory and support Dr. Kim and her family. Amen? Amen. By the way, please know that this will probably have a very large gathering, so you will want to be here on time. Parking will be at a premium. So please keep that in mind. If you're still interested in receiving one of these very special Bibles that we've talked to you about, it's a study Bible, please contact Mr. Franklin at our City Temple office during normal business hours for details. And also, at the end of service today, we want to invite you to stop by the office, and I'm going to remain there and provide for each one of you the 8 Amazing Facts Health. So you want to pick up your free copy of that. We want to make sure that Judge Miller and all that are with you, that you come by and you get a free copy as well. We want you to know how to take care of your body. The Bible says we are fearfully and wonderfully, what, everybody? Made. So it's important, and especially if you're battling with anything or if there is a desire for victory in your life over habits or any addictions, we certainly want to put this in your hands, all right? Let's all repeat our motto. God has a, what, everybody? Special place for you and your family at City Temple. We want to also recognize in closing that there is a special tribute to Mr. Cantrell, the owner and founder of Cantrell Funeral Home. Tomorrow, there's a special tribute service at Burns Seventh-day Adventist Church. Tomorrow from 4 to 8 p.m. If you'd like to come, you want to share some words, we invite you to please put that on your calendar and make sure that you are able to support that family as well. He had contributed so much to our church through the years. Amen? Amen. And service to so many of our families and our loved ones. And so we need to make sure that we save that time and we support his family at their hour of loss. We now want to welcome again our special music that is here with us today, and we invite them to come and provide a special number. After that special number, we will have Teresa Trammell to come up, and she's going to read our scripture for today and then our message of the morning.
Good morning, City Temple Church. Morning. Happy Sabbath. Ken Rory put me up to introducing the second song. So here we go. We're going to be playing Holy, 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 which is the highest form of praise that anyone can offer to God. And I was thinking about this song, and Monday when I heard the news, and learned how some of my children, how Aaron and Leon are hurting right now, I just thought to myself how appropriate this song is, because soon we're all going to be able to sing to our Father, Holy, 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 soon and very soon. Amen.
Father in heaven, it is with deep desire that we long to see your face. We want to be rid of this world and all of its pain, all of its difficulties and challenges. But until such time as Jesus returns, I pray, O Lord, that you would continue to teach us from your word, which we again petition your throne for today, is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. That's what happens when you get caught up in the music. You skip a step.
Our scripture reading will be taken from Judges 6, 12 through 16. I'll give you time to look for it. Again, our scripture reading is going to be taken from Judges 6, 12 through 16. And the angel of the Lord appeared upon him and said unto him, that the Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, then is all this befallen us. And where be all his miracles, which our fathers told us for our saying? Did not the Lord bring us out of Egypt? But now the Lord hath thou forsaken us, and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. And the Lord looked upon him and said, Go into this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I sent thee? And he said unto him, O my Lord, wherefore shall I save Israel? Behold my family and the poor, and I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said unto him, Surely I will be with thee, and thou shalt smite the Midianites as one man.
Amen.
Thank you, Sister Teresa Trammell. Thank you so much. We are providing a study guide for you today, and that study guide is for the purpose of you having a record of what you will learn today. If you are just joining us in the sanctuary, let me reiterate that today at 5 o'clock we begin Pastor Stephen Bohr's special series, God's Prophetic Chain. It is a series that we're broadcasting. It will be carried live stream if you're watching us today on Praise Vision. We want to invite you to tune in at 5 o'clock, and then the messages that are presented will be uploaded on YouTube at DetroitCityTemple.av, DetroitCityTemple.av on YouTube. Tonight, or this evening at 5 o'clock, it's our first segment. It's called God's Prophetic Chain. Tomorrow at 11 a.m., we will have the presentation, Who is the Little Horn? And then the next presentation after tomorrow morning at 11 will be next week, the 12th, The Sword and the Captivity. at 5 p.m. And your handout has a list of all of the subjects and respective times. So please take note of that. I'm speaking slowly to give them a chance to distribute all of the handouts that accompany today's sermon. We have enough copies, I believe, one per family. So couples that are seated together, please be willing to share. Couples that are seated together, please be willing to share. Okay. We want to thank Mrs. Harsney and her, let's just call her musical team. Amen. For accompanying her and for the beautiful music. And did you see her beautiful baby boy? Did you see her beautiful baby boy? Amen. 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 The last time she played here at City Temple, she was expecting. A lot has happened since she was here last. Amen. And we're blessed to have all of our guest here today. Thank you again. We see other guests that have come in. Father in heaven, teach us now from your word. We ask in Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. Go with me again to Judges chapter 6. Judges chapter 6. We're now going to go to the screen very shortly after we read this passage. And I'm going to read what Teresa shared with you once again. Don't read ahead in the programs, okay? Or I should say in your study guide. Stay with me. You want to go with me as we go through this, all right? Don't cheat. All right, good enough. Here it is, Judges chapter 6 and verse 11. This is what the word of God has to say. And there came an angel of the Lord and sat under an oak which was in Ophrah, and that pertained unto Joash the Abarazite, and his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress. Now, a couple of things we ought to see right away. First of all, he is threshing wheat by wine press. It's an odd place. Why would he be doing that? Let's look for the clue. To hide it from who, everybody? The Midianites. Everybody say the Midianites. The Midianites were their cousins. Who were the Midianites? They were cousins. They were cousins to the Israelites. Does anybody remember who the Midianites come from? The Midianites were the offspring of Midian. Midian was the offspring of Keturah and Abraham. Abraham had a wife after Sarah died. What was her name? Keturah. She was a black woman. Amen. Amen. Y'all didn't know that, did you? All right. Yeah, he's decided to integrate the family. All right. However, the Midianites, and how do we know this? Some people say, well, how do you know that? Well, because the Midianites were the ones who were dwelling in the land where Moses retreated to after he killed the Egyptian. Remember that? And that he not only retreated to the Midianites, he married the priest of Midian's daughter. What was her name? Zipporah. Her name was Zipporah. And remember, Miriam and Aaron didn't like her because she was darker. Y'all remember that? See, it's important that you put all of the Bible together. All right? So are you learning something today so far? We're going to learn a little bit more because this message is entitled The Law of the Minimum. So let's go on a little bit further. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, the Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then is all this befallen us? Fair question. And where be all his miracles, which our fathers told us of? Good question. Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? Good question. But now the Lord hath forsaken us. Really? And hath delivered us into the hand of the Midianites. Really? And the Lord looked upon him and said, go in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I sent thee? And he said unto him, O my Lord, wherewith shall I save Israel? Behold, my family is what, everybody? Poor. My family is what? In Manasseh. Now, this means that Gideon was a direct descendant of Joseph. Who were the sons of Joseph? Ephraim and Manasseh. So Gideon comes of the tribe of Manasseh. So he is a direct descendant of Joseph. All right. Several generations later, nevertheless. And then he says, I am the least in my father's house, which meant that of the tribe of Manasseh, his family was indeed really small. And then he said unto, and the Lord said unto him, surely I will do what, everybody?
I will be with thee. All right, verse 16, read with me. And the Lord said unto him, come on, let's read, church. And the Lord said unto him, surely I will, what, everybody? Be with thee, and thou shalt, what, everybody? Smite the Midianites as how many men? How many men? The law of the minimum. The law of the minimum. All right, let's go to the screen. All right, the law of the minimum. Let's use some practical experiences so that we can really understand what the law of the minimum looks like. Because often we are confused about what it means when we say the law of the minimum. The parent company for American Airlines, AMR, the nation's third largest carrier, filed for bankruptcy citing two things. What did they cite? High labor costs. Come on, read with me. What? High labor costs and in what economy? Volatile economy. Now, this was in November 2011, and this was carried in the LA Times. I use their old logo because their new logo is so unfamiliar to you because most of us don't fly every day. So I wanted to be sure that you really knew who we were talking about. American Airlines. American Airlines, 5 years ago. Everybody say 5 years ago. 5 years ago, they went what? Bankrupt. Everybody say bankrupt. Bankrupt means that you have more expenses than you have income, that you have more on the negative side than you do on the positive side. So they decided, they proposed, they're based out of Dallas, Texas, they proposed to lay off how many people? I'm glad somebody's reading. How many? 13,000. They laid off how many people, everybody? 13,000 people. Called the law of the minimum. And have you ever noticed that companies will quickly lay off people and you will say, but I thought I had job. What's that S word? Security. No, you don't. Okay? Let me tell you why you don't really have job security. You don't have job security because it's not your company. Remember, I have told you that one of the things, the principles that God wants us to know, and this comes from the Old Testament, is that God wanted his people to own their own business because you can't fire you. Now, you can drive yourself in the ground. You can drive. You can push yourself to excel, but you can't fire yourself. I don't like my job. If you are working for you and you are dependent upon you and the Lord to pay your bills, you're going to get out of the bed and do what? Go to work, or else you're going to starve. Am I right? Can you imagine calling in sick on yourself? Who are you going to call? You lean on them in the pillow. You know what? I don't feel like getting up today. I really don't want to go to work. And then you think about all of your accounts payable. Am I right? And then you get up out of the bed. Am I right? And as soon as you wake up, you say, I got to hit it. That was what my mother used to say to us. My mother used to say, that's a hardworking woman. Do you know my mother is 93 years old? She said the other day, I talked to her this week, and she said, you know, she said, son, your mother has aches and pains, but I looked at that garden and I looked at all of the weeds that needed to be pulled, and I said, I got some Bengay and I got some aspirin. I'm going to work. They don't make them like that anymore, do they? Huh? And mom said, she said, you know, she said, when I went out there, she said, son, I pulled a few weeds, and she said, I came inside it, and she said, your mother took a really hot shower, and after the hot shower, she said, I had to rub some Bengay on my shoulder and my neck, and my bursitis was bothering me, and I couldn't lift my arm, and I took a couple of aspirin. She said, but guess what? I got those weeds pulled. You got to love her, amen? You have to love that strong work ethic. She's working for herself. Okay, well, we go back to the screen. So let's look at who they laid off. Fleet Service and Transport Workers Union, approximately 4,200. Flight attendants, approximately 2,300. I don't care how pretty you are. They say you look good, but you're fired. Amen. Management Support Staff, amen, approximately 1,400. Mechanics and related, approximately. Let me say this to you. If you are ever a frequent flyer on an airline that goes bankrupt, since you now know that they will lay off mechanics, choose a different airline. Y'all didn't hear that, all right? Okay? Then pilots, approximately how many? Well, they need pilots, so they were going to lay off very few of them because their business is what? Flying. All right. Few businesses, and this is what the airline analyst, Joseph Weisenfeld said, or Fall said. Few businesses have as many variables and challenges as airlines. They are capital intensive. Now, when they use the term in business, capital intensive, what they mean is that constant cash infusion is required. In other words, cash flow has to be high because expenses are constant. So in other words, let me say it this way. There are some businesses that operate in cycles, but because airlines are having to fly every day and they put hundreds and literally thousands of planes up in the air globally, the world's third largest airline, or at least America's third largest airline, their demand on their income is enormous. Airlines are fossil fuel dependent and often at the mercy of fuel price volatility. The reason that they have not really dropped their fares, by the way, in recent years, although the fuel prices have dropped, is because they're trying to recover from all the years that they had high fuel prices. That's just a little tidbit, okay? Operations are labor intensive. Have you ever noticed how many people touch a plane before it goes off the ground? Have you ever really counted? Just start counting people. And you think about all the people that touch a plane, the people who are loading the food, the people who are emptying the waste, the people who are walking through and cleaning. In fact, they decided, most airlines have decided to cut down on that expense, and they make the, in fact, airlines like Southwest and some others, they have the pilot coming out of the cockpit and he picks up trash now. I'm serious. When I was flying all the time, you would see the pilot comes out, he greets everybody. As soon as the plane is empty, boom, they just start walking down the aisle picking up garbage. Labor intensive. You got to cut costs somewhere. The law of the minimum. Okay, let's go back. All right, here we go. Operations are labor intensive, pardon me, and subject to government control and what, everybody? And then a lot depends on the what? So when you have these winter storms, they can't fly. When you have volcanoes that erupt like we saw in Iceland, it shut down most of Europe a few years ago. So it depends on the on the elements, the weather elements. All right, human realities. Here's some realities. The unanticipated. You and I must always function knowing that there is an unanticipated element. Always know that. There's the unanticipated. There's the unexplainable. And then there's the unexpected. All right, God's values in action. I'm going to give you just a couple of examples in scripture to show you, to prove to you that God doesn't need a lot of people to get the job done. I'm saying something to you today. And I want you to stay with me today because I'm really saying something to you today. All right? He doesn't need a lot of people to get the what, everybody? Job done. When you go to Genesis chapter 7, God repopulated the earth by twos. Are y'all with me? The clean animals went in by what? The unclean animals went in by what? Twos. And the clean animals went in by what? Seven. All right. In John chapter 6, Jesus fed 5,000 men beside women and children with how many? Five loaves and what? Two fishes. See, it doesn't take God a lot to get a lot done. In Acts chapter 8, verses 26 through 37, we have the account of the Ethiopian eunuch and his baptism. And do you realize that as a result of that one baptism, the Ethiopian Coptic church was founded? Isn't that amazing? One baptism. One. Everybody say one. One. And then in Acts chapter 17 and verse 6, the impact of two. Humble, fully surrendered instruments are used by the Lord to show how vain and impotent are those who trust in, read these three elements or worldly values, rank, power, and what? Learning. Now, it's important to have your credentials because I would not want a judge on the bench who didn't have credentials. Are y'all with me? I mean, if you don't have credentials, if you have not been to law school, I do not want to see you when I walk in the courtroom. All right? Because you may, it may be one of those days that you don't like me. And I would be in trouble. All right? But the law holds the lawyer in check. Amen? All right. Well, the same is true for ethical responsibilities for a physician. If I go to see a physician, the physician has an ethical responsibility to provide reasonable service. This is important for us to understand. And so even in the church of God, the church of God requires that reasonable service can be expected from those who serve in a particular responsibility. I just said something to you. I just said something, all right? Let's go a little bit further. Let's go a little bit further. All right, so business values are not biblical values. Here we go. God's values counter the carnal, the cultural, and the empirical. What am I saying? Our carnal desires is that we attach ourselves to people we know. So in other words, when it comes to making decisions, we make decisions based on familiarity and comfort level. I was just talking to my son Matthew this week, and I was sharing with Matthew when he was talking about how he wanted to know how he did in his radio program. He is now a radio announcer. He's kind of like a DJ, you know, but it's a Christian radio station down there, Southwestern Adventist University. And he said, so did you listen to it, Dad? I said, yes. He said, how do you think I did? I said, well, remember now, I've got years in broadcasting, so let me tell you what I think. And he said, all right, here we go. And this is what I told him. I said, now, Matthew, you did extremely well, but I could hear nervousness in your voice. I said, were you nervous? He said, yes, I was very nervous. I said, Matthew, it's only a mic. It's only a mic. I said, so just pretend like you're talking to mom and dad. All right. We're the only ones listening, even though you know that there are other people out there. And so when you're talking to the mic, don't be afraid of it. I said, even if you have to touch it every now and then, I said, be comfortable in your environment. So I gave him some tips for how to function in that context. And so often we fail to recognize that when we are providing a service, that there is an expectation of performance. Are y'all not with me today? Don't check out on this sermon. This sermon is important. Okay? I'm saying something in this sermon. All right? So I have an expectation of what, everybody? Come on, say that P word one more time. If you can't perform, I don't need you. Period. Let's go back to the screen. All right? And we're going to get to Gideon in just a minute. But we needed to set the boundaries in a human context. We often lean to culture. So majority of the people in this congregation right now are of African American descent. We have some Caribbean Americans and we have some who are from the continent of Africa and we have some Caucasians, but nevertheless, the majority African Americans. But let me tell you what's interesting about the cultural aspects. In the human context, we will default to people that we know and that are our culture. Is that natural? Is that natural? Say amen. So don't get hung up when white folk hire white folk. Because that's who their neighbors are. That's who they're related to. But they shouldn't get all bent out of shape when we hire black folk. Because we are connected to, related to who? Black folk. Amen. And when people are from the Caribbean, and you get excited, you say, but everybody was like them. Well, they from the Caribbean. Who else do you think they're supposed to be with? People who are from the what? Caribbean or the Caribbean. All right. So why am I making this point? Because we should not forget as we begin to unpack this story that the Midianites were related to the Israelites. But yet they found themselves on different sides of God's equation. Okay, we're going to go back to the screen and the empirical. Now, the empirical is a scientific. You know, you get all your data and you wrap it in and you say, well, this is why we ought to do this and so on and so forth. But I've got news for you. God goes outside the boundaries of that which is scientifically supported. All right? Because in this account, God is going to defy the odds. All right? Here is your biblical principle. All right? It's the law of the minimum. So everybody say that. One more time. Okay, the law of the minimum. This is what it looks like. The law of the minimum, Judges 6. We just read through that and also chapter 7. So I want you to read chapter 7 when you get home, because that plays out the rest of the story, Judges chapter 7. Here are God's values, a submissive character. What is his first desire? Okay, I knew the church would get weak on that, all right? What is the first thing that God requires of us? A submissive character. What's the second thing? A humble character. What's the third thing? Cooperative character. What does this say? Read this with me. The leader whom God chose to overthrow the Midianites occupied, know what, everybody, prominent position in Israel. He was not a what? He was not a? He thought himself the least in his father's house, but God saw in him, listen to this, this is important. God saw in him a man of what? And what else? What did God see in him? We look at credentials, we look at experience, we look at tenure, we look at years of service in the church, we look at years of membership. God did not ask him, how long, how old, where have you been to school? He said, I see two things, courage and integrity. Don't you know it would be wonderful if we could just get some integrity right about now? Am I right? We can't seem to find integrity with any political candidate that's running. Neither one of them have integrity. Huh? Just you go to war Trump and then the women come out of the closet. Am I right about it? You turn and you go toward Hillary and then they get more emails. Y'all with me today? Huh? So when we put our trust in humanity, we are bound for failure. We will be disappointed. God said, I want a person of, what's the key word? Integrity. All right? Let's go back to the screen. Here we go. A man of courage and integrity, willing to follow the guidance of the Lord, willing to follow the guidance of who, everybody? The Lord. God does not always choose for his work men of the greatest talents, but he selects those whom he can, what, everybody? Best use before honor is, what, everybody? Humility. I'm going to read this for you. The Lord can work most effectually through those who are most sensible of their own, what's that word? If you and I understand our deficits, God can use us. Isn't that a beautiful statement? If you and I believe that we are all that in a bag of chips, guess what? That's the first thing to disqualify you from leadership. I had, since we have started the election process here at the church, I had someone send me a text. This is what the text said. I hope that you will consider so-and-so for a particular responsibility. They have been most effective in that responsibility, and I hope that they will be able to continue to serve. What did I write back? If you know me yet, what did I write back? Yes, I did. Sunshine, you're still learning me. I wrote back quickly. This is what I wrote. Your text is out of order. It is both inappropriate and unethical. I said, this is not a campaign season in the church, and nobody has one up on anybody else. Everybody say, Was that a true word? Because guess what? If I gave into that text, it meant that when I walk into a committee as a chairman, I have to immediately begin to manipulate the system so I can get a particular outcome. Am I right? That's neither courage nor integrity.
I'm just trying to teach you something this morning. All right, let's go back to the screen. We're almost done. So the Lord can work most effectually through those who are most sensible of their own insufficiency and who will rely upon him as their leader and source of strength. He will make them strong by uniting their weakness to his might, and wise by connecting their ignorance, their what? To his wisdom. So God, everybody say God. God, put him first. He does more with little
than that we could ever do it much. By the simplest means, what is tested? What is tested? What is tested? Those who in time of peril were intent upon supplying their own wants were not the men to be trusted in an emergency. Okay, let me fast forward and tell you what happens with the story as I draw to a conclusion. Let me share with you. We all know the story of Gideon, but let me just do a retake for you. So eventually, Gideon gets down to 300 men from 20-some thousand. He starts out with how many? 20-some thousand. I think it's like 25,000. And then he comes down to 300. And notice how simple the test was that God used. Simple test. Those who were committed to go to battle, they scooped the water and kept moving. Those who were timid, weak of heart, jelly backs, am I doing all right, Sister Flowers? Yeah. All right. Jelly backs. Okay, they got down in the water and they kept drinking because they were trying to delay the time of contact. You see, the longer they kept their face in the water, then the longer they were delaying the forcing of arms. Y'all not with me today? So if they kept their face in the water, they kept looking around and say, are they in the battle yet? Are they up there in the battle yet? Yeah, let them go on with their bad self. I'm going to stay here in the water. Have you ever noticed that, you know, there's a particular ratio, there's a rule of thumb, there's a statistically proven factor that in the church, 20% of the people do 80% of the work. It's a 20-80 theory, okay, and it plays out. 20% of the church also financially supports the rest of the church. 20%, everybody say 20%. Okay, so if you just start counting off, you know, around this room, and if there were 200 people here, you could say 40 people were carrying the rest of the church. Wow. Everybody say wow. I know. No, it's not good, but that's a proven statistic. If the treasurer rolled out all of the details of your financial giving right now, and I looked at it, I could support that theory. I could support that theory. I know I could. I've passed it long enough. I've seen it. It's proven. Even when we select officers, 20% of the officers do 80% of the work. Let's get back to the 300. Okay? So here we go. All right? So this is how we're going to end up today. So those who in time of peril were intent on supplying their own wants were not the men. They were not the what? To be trusted in an emergency. The Lord has no place in his work for the indolent. Now, indolent is a nice word, but let me give you a four-letter word that works in place of indolent. It's called lazy. It's called what? Lazy and self-indulgent. In other words, they are self-protecting, self-protective. They look out for their self-interest, all right? The law of the minimum. All right. Now, you don't know we're going to just land like that. That's the way planes land. Planes just go, bloop, and they're done. Okay, we're done. All right? Let me see the handout for just a second, sweetheart. I think that there may be a piece in here that I did not do. All right. Was there a slide that I missed? Yes, it was. Thank you, sweetheart, for sharing that with me. All right? Notice three more slides. The 300 chosen men not only possessed courage and self-control, but they were men of what, everybody? Faith. They had not, what, everybody? Defiled themselves with what? Idolatry. Let's read the two more slides. There's one more on page 5, and there's one on the back of page 6. God could do what? Direct them, and through them, he could work what? Deliverance for Israel. Success does not depend on what? Numbers. God can deliver by few as well as by many. He is honored not so much by the great numbers as by the what? Character of those who serve him. Go with me now to page 6. That's the last page. Look on the back. Here it is. These are the four points I want to leave you with. Here they are. God wants four things. What does God want? Four things, all right? He wants reverence for God's word and God's work. Faith in God and faithfulness in what? Service through what? And then godly what? Godly confidence. Those are the four things that God wants. So when we talk about the minimum, notice that God worked the larger group down to a small number. And he did that purposefully because the rest of them didn't want to be there anyhow. They wanted position, but they didn't want accountability. They wanted power and presence, but they didn't want responsibility. Because only the 300 went to war after the test. And once the test began, 300 went down with the most unseemly method of attack. Torches inside of a pitcher. I mean, come on, laugh with me, Brother Walker. I mean, that's Brother Walker laughing upstairs, all right? I mean, isn't that humorous? It is humorous. I mean, you put a pitcher, a burning torch inside of a pitcher. You break the pitcher. But notice that God, give me my backup music right here. This is where we close out. Let me share this with you. This is so exciting to me because, Teresa, what they did was the element of surprise. It's called shock and awe. They use it today in the military. What is it called? Shock and awe. And this is what they did. They broke the pitchers. And the Midianites and the Amalekites both were awakened out of their sleep to bright lights running through their camp. Can you imagine someone running through your bedroom with a bright light at 2 a.m., 3 a.m. in the morning? Would you lose your mind? Sure you would. You would start screaming. Am I right? You would fumble for the phone, and then the lights keep running past you. Ah, where did I leave my phone? And then you're trying to figure out what to do, and then you need your glasses, but you've knocked your glasses on the floor. Am I right? And God forbid you only wear contacts, and the contacts in the bathroom, and you can't get to your contacts to put them in, and you don't have any saline solution right by your bed, so you can't just drop them in your eye. Am I making sense, people? Okay? And then they wake up as these guys are running past their tents, and they're shocked into a stupor, and they start killing each other. And Gideon was used because he had courage and he had integrity. Those must be pretty important values for leaders. Y'all got quiet on me, City Temple. They must be pretty important values for leaders. So let's ask ourselves a couple of questions before we pray. Some people are weak by nature. Am I right? That's true. Male or female? Now, if a female is weak, we forgive them. If a man is weak, that's a problem. Am I making it plain? I mean, it is a problem. It is. And this is not a sermon about marriage, and so I'm not going to go to meddling, but I'm just going to leave it right there.
that even dogs don't respect weak men. There's a dog in my house. I don't like that dog. It's my wife's dog. That's her dog, okay? Well, it's Gabriella's dog. Even look at she's getting away from it. She said, not my dog, okay? It's Gabriella's dog. But do you know I trained that dog from when he was very, very little. He was a pup. I'm not mean. I'm very firm. And so she loves him. She cuddles him. She plays with his ears. He's a fuzzy, wuzzy dog. And she just loves the dog. And when he's there laying beside her, she puts her feet on him and rubs her feet all in his fur. And he just loves it. He lays back. They're bonded. And I'm just using this as an example. And the dog will come up the stairs. And she'll say, now, Winston, go to your room. And he just stands there. He has a mind of his own, okay? It's a male dog, okay? It's a male dog. Y'all get that? Okay? Do you have an idea where this story is going? Okay. So he just stands there and she says, Winston, go to your room. Winston looks around like, oh my, she's bothering me again. I don't want to go to my room. Okay. Really? He gets that look in his face. And I stand there and I watch these dynamics. And she'll say, Winston, didn't I say go to your room? It's like talking to a child. And Winston just moves a few more steps away from her, you know. And then I come out. And I simply say, Winston, get in your room. And what do you think Winston does? Goes to his room. I never feed Winston. I never walk Winston. I never water Winston. I never take Winston on a bathroom walk. I do nothing with Winston. But Winston knows that when I speak, I mean what I say. So courage is important, because I told my wife one day, I was looking at Winston. He was laying there after he had eaten. He was just stretched out on the floor. I said, you know, this dog does us no good. I did. I said, sweetheart, I love you, but this dog does us no good. I said, he sucks up air. He lays on the floor all day. He eats up our food, which is bending our budget. And I said, the only thing I got to tell you is he produces nothing. He's a guard dog. Okay. All right. Do y'all get my point, people? Non-productive dog. So God worked his way down to the productive. It's not in your numbers. It's in your productivity. It's in your what, everybody? Productivity. God is not looking for people who just want to parade, be up front, march across the front, always want to be up front. Okay. He's looking for productive people. People with courage. People with integrity. Am I saying something to you today? So let us note these biblical principles. Don't worry about the mother and child. That's her child. Let her do what she got to do. Amen? I hope that she's going out to spank him. If that's what... We won't be visiting him in jail later. Look at the judge clapping her hands. All right. She's helping me on this one. OK. Train up a child in the way he should go. And what? When he's older, he will not what? Depart from it. Have we all learned something today? Amen. And I hope that the way it was presented, that you did not feel that I was trying to lower the boom. OK. But I do hope that we all understand that God is looking for leaders with courage and what? Integrity. Amen. We have a closing hymn, but I want to ask you, if you know that you need courage, everybody can use a little more courage. Amen. Some of us are afraid of the devil, and the Lord has already given us the power to walk in his strength. Amen. In Christ Jesus. Some of us are afraid of our children, and our children are running our homes, running our budgets. Some men are afraid of their wives. I'm serious. Some wives are afraid of their husbands. Some husbands are mean. Don't be mean. But you need courage. You still need courage. You don't have to be mean to have courage. Okay? Because I still have the dog, so that's how you know I'm not mean. If you want to know if your pastor's mean, I still have the dog. The dog has been with us how many years? 5 years. Winston. Winston Carrington Bancroft. That's the dog's name. Winston. Look at my wife. She's so happy. I live for that smile. I live for that smile. Winston Carrington Bancroft. If I was me, when she went to work, she'd come back and that dog would be gone. Okay. But I also am a man of integrity. So when I told she and the kids, I said, okay, we can have a dog. I go in my room and I close the door and I say, Lord, why did I ever promise that we could have that dog? But I have to be a man of my word, don't I? So I had to be a man of my word. So until such time as Gabriella or Matthew or, well, Christine just got a dog, or Samuel wants the dog, or Deidre puts him on eBay or Craigslist, I'll have a dog because I love my wife. How many of us need courage today? How many of us want the Lord to make us individuals of higher integrity, greater integrity? Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven. Father in heaven, we want to ask you right now to give us what we need. The deficiencies that we have, we ask you to take them away. And we ask you, Lord, to fill us with joy and happiness, but also make us people of courage and integrity. Help us to stand for truth though the heavens fall. Help us, O God, to overcome the things that, as Paul said, so easily beset us. In other words, overwhelm us, take us over. Bless us now. And Lord, we ask a very special prayer on Judge Miller. And we ask, Lord, that your will would be done. But I ask also, Lord, that if you see fit to return her to the bench, that she will always be a person of integrity, a person of courage, willing to stand for the law, to stand for right, not bought or sold. Help us, O God, to be people that will live according to the word of God and to what you expect of us. We ask in Jesus' name and for his sake, let everyone say, amen, amen. All right. Lead us in our, you need the mic. All right. Let's all stand for our closing song.
Amen, amen. Please join in with us. Number 65 in your hymn books. We'll sing the first and last verse. God be with you till we meet again.
God would be with you till we meet again. By his counsel that uphold you, with his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again, till we meet. Till we meet.
Courage and integrity that we should have to rightly represent you in every aspect of our lives. May we be known in the community, the city of Detroit, as a church where we will not be bought or sold, because we stand representing Jesus on his inerrant word. Thank you, O Lord, for teaching us today, and bless us as we go forward into this coming week with a new commitment to stand in courage and faith and integrity. For we ask it in Christ's name. Let everyone say amen. Amen. Please be seated for just a moment. As we are dismissed, there's a special favor that I have to ask of you today. Today I need to meet with the church family for just a few minutes, so we're going to allow our guests to be dismissed at this point. I'm going to ask Elder Hayward Penny, our first elder, and Elder Carey, if you would greet our guests as they exit. And if you're a guest today, we invite you to meet Elder Hayward Penny and Elder Carey, if you would both stand at this time, all right, so that they can see you. And you would head to the vestibule, and Elder Taylor. Ella Taylor, there you are. You're over here. Okay, if you would join them. And we are thankful that you're here today. We invite you to come back at 5 o'clock and for the very special prophecy segment. And let me get just a little bit more background music, Marcus. And again, on tomorrow at 11 o'clock. Again, our prophecy seminar this evening with Pastor Stephen Bohr at 5 o'clock and tomorrow morning at 11 a.m. All right? Members of the church, we ask you to stay by for about 15 minutes, if you will. A couple things I want to cover with you. All right? God bless you. Let's everybody say amen for our guest today. Some drove all the way from Grand Rapids. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Some right here in the city. Let's remember that Mr. Gary Turner, your uncle's name, Cantrell. Okay? Mr. Cantrell's.